Now, I am not one of those people who compulsively read science fiction. I enjoy watching it on television. I love it in Star Trek, for instance, when Scotty shouts, "Lock on to his coordinates." It always sounds so painful. But there's little doubt that in the last couple of decades, the science fiction novel has really come into its own. Wander into any bookshop and you'll see entire shelves devoted to sci-fi titles. In fact, some people argue that they offer a unique form of literary expression and should be evaluated on that basis. Not so David Pringle, editor of the sci-fi magazine Interzone, who's just produced a critical work entitled Science Fiction, The 100 Best Novels. He's judged them on their individual merits, and he's here to explain why. Joining him is one of his chosen writers, Harry Harrison, who wrote the book Make Room, Make Room, which was later filmed with Charlton Heston and Edward G. Robinson as Soylent Green. Explain to me how you define a science fiction novel.
It's been tried many, many times. It's very difficult to define, but I would say it's anything, any form of fantastic fiction which is rooted in some kind of reality. And for us nowadays, that means the scientific worldview. You know, we don't believe in magic, most of us. So anything which takes as its jumping off point scientific rationality, scientific theories of the far future, outer space, the distant past, any of these sort of areas that have been opened up by modern science.
So do you disapprove of pure fantasy?
I don't disapprove, but for the purpose of this book, 100 Best Science Fiction Novels, I had to define science fiction fairly rigorously. I had to keep my choice of books to science fiction as I see it. There's always dispute, obviously, between individuals as to what science fiction is. But I had to lay down some kind of law for the purpose of the book, and that I've done. Therefore, I've excluded all fantasy. I mean, I like fantasy.
Lord of the Rings.
Yes, indeed, I like Lord of the Rings, but that's a different game.
Now, why did you take it from 1949 onwards? Because that way you cancel out things like The War of the Worlds, you know, 2000 Leagues Under the Sea. Why did you choose 1949 as the magic
date? I didn't mean to cancel out H.G. Wells in any sense, because H.G. Wells, of course, is a great writer, and I admire him enormously. But I felt that he and many of the other writers, like Aldous Huxley, who wrote Brave New World, and Jules Verne, of course, I felt that these people had been covered adequately in many critical books, and there are many reading lists which draw attention to them. But I wanted to cover the modern period. And in fact, it's true, I think, to say that in the late 1940s, that was the period when I chose to start my survey, that's when science fiction became labelled as such in book form. It's when publishers in this country, at any rate, started to put science fiction on book covers.
And it became a recognised form.
Yes, it became a recognised genre. Whereas before, you know, they were published, we retrospectively call them science fiction. But books like Brave New World were not published at the time, in 1932 in that case, as science fiction. So I chose to concentrate on the modern era, which has been less well covered.
I wonder, Harry, why so many writers are turning to science fiction.
Well, it's a successful form of fiction right now. We lived for a long time in the pulp ghetto, and the first books published as science fiction were in the 50s, believe it or not, first paperbacks. And I think what's happened, obviously has happened, the world likes science fiction from the films now, and
it seems to be predominantly male-preserved. That's a curious thing.
Not really, no.
Very few female
Oh, there are some very, very good writers, some very, very bad female writers, like some very bad male writers. But right now, a lot of fantasy is being written that goes to science fiction readers, and most of that is edited by women and written by women.
Now, do you operate within the guidelines that David was talking about there? I mean, how did you get the idea for Make Room, Make Room?
Well, I see a copy lying there. At the time I wrote it, through scientific journals, I was very well aware that we had a population problem. In fact, I was living in Mexico. I went back to Mexico a few years later, and they had doubled the population.
So you actually saw an example?
I saw it happening, and that's your idea for a science fiction book, right there. How can I bring this particular problem to people? I'm a science fiction writer. All my interests are in science fiction as a writer. I cast it in New York, the year 2000. We'll be alive, those are lucky of us, put our seatbelts on. And we'll show this view of the future, this very negative view. The science fiction does that. You don't want to write a utopian novel, just people playing harps, much as I love the harp, you don't want to read about it. But dystopian novel, how rotten the world's going to be, that's what we want to see.
That sells books.
Oh, that sells books. And keeps the reader interested, moves the plot along. Yeah. You have to entertain your reader. If you don't entertain your reader, forget about it.
A very famous science fiction writer, Nigel Neal, who created Quatermass, once said to me that science fiction is never about the future, it is always about the present. And it's true that if you look at a television series like Star Trek, it's a perfect mirror of the attitudes and problems which existed in the United States at the time the series was made.
Yes.
But can you see, looking back, David, can you see any predominant themes that came out at particular times?
Yes, I believe it's possible to generalize and say that in the 50s, much science fiction was concerned with the bomb, with life after the bomb, some hypothetical future when, after a great Third World War had taken place. That theme has re-emerged recently for obvious reasons, but it was particularly predominant in the 50s. In the 60s, at the time Harry Harrison wrote Make Room, Make Room, I think overpopulation and pollution became major themes. And in the 70s, perhaps it was softening into ecology and a lot of feminism in the 70s from the... there are women writers, especially in America, and many of them are feminists. In the 80s, I think we see a bit of a resurgence of high-tech stories, especially stories to do with computers and microprocessors and all this that's burgeoning around us, obviously affecting our lives right now.
Just give me an example of one of your favourites that would reflect that kind of idea.
That kind... Well, it's To begin at the very beginning, one of the earliest books I've chosen from 1949 is a book called Earth Abides by George R. Stewart. It's not actually about the bomb, but it's a post-disaster story. It's about a plague that nearly wipes out the human race, and there's just a small handful of people left. And these people try to rebuild a society. They succeed, but they fail. They succeed insofar as they rebuild a kind of society, but it's not the society they once had, because they realize that things were much, much too complex. We live in a society where everything's interlocked and everybody's helping each other in many invisible ways. And so the book makes that point, really, that you can't rebuild from scratch easily.
Are you conscious yourself, Harry, of making a point when you're writing?
Certain books will be light, humorous entertainments. But even those books have a feeling of a global attitude, you might say. Certain other books, like Make Room, Make Room, which, to correct a point Dave made in his book and verbally here, was the very first book on overpopulation. The rest followed me.
One of your more recent ones was West of Eden,
which is
one of those mammoth epics for which you required a furniture removal van when you pick up the paperback.
Still going on, yes.
But how did you get the idea for that?
From television, I'll be happy to say. Okay. I saw a Canadian who was discussing what the world would be like today, or what the intelligent dinosaurs would be like if the world had not been sort of wiped out by a meteor 60,000 years, or 60 million years ago.
But they believe that a meteor hit the Earth...
Pretty much so. Three-quarters of all the species died in a matter of decades, hundreds of years. And at that time, mammals were just about this big. Then the age of the dinosaurs ended, the age of the mammals began. My simple idea was, my goodness, what would the world be like today? 5 years later, the book was finished. It was a very massive work, and a new thing in the world I invented for it called science faction. In that I had friends who were specialized in linguistics and biology help me to create this world. And that's a different kind of book to do. It's a lot of fun to do.
But I just wonder how you take something, a concept, which is almost beyond imagination, and convince the reader that a world he knows doesn't exist is real for the time he's reading the book. Do you give him certain things he can identify with?
No, just talent.
Talking about talent, but quickly, let me come back to you, David. Looking back at books like The War of the Worlds and the Jules Verne fantasies, how do they stand up today to the ravages of time?
Very well indeed. The fact that we remember them, the fact that they're still household names, Verne and Wells and the books they wrote, proves that. There were many, many other contemporary writers of theirs who wrote so-called scientific romances. The term science fiction didn't exist then. They're forgotten. We remember Verne, we remember Wells, and there's a good reason for that. It's because they were very fine writers.
And let's hope that they'll remember Harry Harrison.
Indeed.
Harry and David, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.